or two others in here, but I think in deference to our distinguished guest and to those folks who've come in to visit with Herb, it's really a great pleasure to welcome Herb Cohen back to the Smeal College, Herb's our distinguished speaker. He spoke to our bargaining negotiations class quite a few years ago at the request of Federal Judge Julius Sport. Okay, is that right? Stanley Sport. Stanley Sport. So, and this time, though, we went to a higher authority, which was Herb's wife, Helen, whose job, it seems, is to keep Herb on the road as much as possible. Herb has served as an advisor to Presidents Carter, Reagan on combating terrorism. He was involved in resolving the Iranian hostage crisis. He helped shape the U.S. government's response to the skyjacking of TWA Flight 847 and the seizure of Achille Lauro. He still advises the White House on issues ranging from domestic political strategy to the Gulf crisis. Herb's clients include the U.S. Department of Justice, the State Department, the FBI, U.S. Conference of Mayors, as well as numerous business executives and large corporations. He's been a guest on The Tonight Show, Good Morning America, Donahue, Nightline, and Larry King Show. So, with no further ado, let me introduce Herb.
Thank you very much, I guess, to Professors Chatterjee and Lillian for inviting me. Thank you all for showing up, particularly those who may be familiar with my work. When I was here a number of years ago, someone told me it was 8 years ago, someone asked me a question before I got up to speak, and which was, how did I get invited to speak at this distinguished university? And I asked the person that asked me, how do you think? And he threw up his hands and said, who knows? Maybe ethnic or geographic balance. Well, if any of you feel that way, let me initially disabuse you of that notion, because my real name is J. Wellington Cartwright III, which I have changed for business purposes to Herbert Cohen. I myself was born and raised in Cheyenne, Wyoming, often at a young age adopted by Vietnamese boat people. And early on, they moved our family to Appalachia, where I grew up playing Little League polo and spent my weekends riding to the hounds. Thereafter, our family migrated to the Northeast, to metropolitan New York City, to a neighborhood called Bensonhurst, now known for its hospitality to strangers. And with all of this by way of my own eclectic background, it was perhaps natural that I got involved in the subject of negotiations. But then again, all of you know a great deal about that subject. I say that because whenever we attempt to reconcile differences, resolve disputes, manage conflict, establish or adjust relationships, we're playing the negotiating game. Indeed, in your career out in the commercial arena, you will find that the new buzzword of today are things like strategic alliances, mergers and acquisitions, restructuring, and all of those things require negotiating skill. And so, as far as I'm concerned, one of the most important things you should bring out with you into the business world is the ability to negotiate. Indeed, it is the game of life. And please note that I refer to it as a game because I'd like you to see it that way, because a game is where you care, really care, but not that much. Now, why do I say that? Because who's the worst person that you negotiate for? I think the answer is probably yourself. I know that's true in my case. I do exceptionally well negotiating on behalf of others. In fact, to be candid with you, that is how I earn a substantial living. I try to have as my clients very wealthy entrepreneurs, large corporations with money to spend, and they operate on their behalf in deal making. And the way I am compensated is I get a meager, a modest percentage of an enormous deal. This works out well for myself and my family, and so I must be pretty good at doing that. Yet when I negotiate on behalf of myself, I am close to inept. I am pathetic. Now, why is that the case? Do you believe it is because I am lacking in self-esteem? Let me assure you, that is not so. In fact, if I could be more effective for myself and less effective for you. I prefer it that way. But in truth, I am better for you. Why? Because I don't even know you. I mean, I care about you, but not that much. And that attitude tends to give me altitude and perspective. See, every one of you in this room know that the single best way to make a good deal is to convey to the other side, I can live without this deal. I've got other options and other alternatives. Indeed, as the great negotiator Kenny Rogers once said, you got to know when to hold them, and once in a while be prepared to fold them and walk away. And if the other side just senses you might fold them and walk away, they don't let you fold them and walk away. And so the operative attitude for success and satisfaction in all of life's negotiations is really to care, but not that much. See, the problem with most of us being raised in this environment, in this culture, is we perhaps tend to be too adversarial in situations which involve long-term relationships. And so what you want to try to do is see yourself when you go out into the business world as a problem solver. How can we come up with creative solutions that provide for joint gain? Which means that it's not necessarily your initial way. See, my initial way of solving this problem, of determining who gets what, makes me a winner and you a loser. Your initial way does the same thing from your perspective. And so what you want to try to do is to find a third way alternative that can provide for joint gain. And that's why it's important to try to drain the emotional content from life's conflicted situations. You got to look at situations, even involving lives, where there's a lot at stake and say, hey, this is a blip on the radar screen of eternity. This is a walnut in the batter of life. I'm caring, but not that much. And that will help you considerably. Now, what negotiating is really all about, it's voluntary decision making. Unlike the great growth industry of our time, litigation, negotiation in the end requires two people voluntarily saying yes. The difficulty with that is that very often you don't encounter that. In fact, occasionally people will say to me, Herb, in your career, have you ever gone into a situation where two people right at the outset are saying yes? And the answer to that is no. Why would they hire me? See, right now there's not two people sitting in Chicago, and one says to the other, I think your business is worth $8 million. The other says, I concur. I think we've got a deal here. Let's give this guy Cohen a call on the East Coast, bring him out here and get a percentage of the action. I don't get those calls, okay? Let me tell you when they call me. Well, one person says, I think your business is worth $8 million. And the other says, I'm offended by that chintzy, niggling, paltry, and pathetic offer that you've just made, if you could call it that. My grandfather started this business worth $80 million. The only way I would even consider what you said is if you threaten to rip the eyeballs from my skull, if you threaten to tear the tongue from the roof of my mouth, if you threaten to maim, murder, and destroy my family, and I consider that a viable threat, then I might consider it. As far as you're concerned, right now, shove it. The person to whom that is said to will then call my office. And here's the way they kind of put it to us. We have a problem involving perception here. And perhaps Herb can fly to Chicago and serve as a catalyst to facilitate things. And Herb, quite often, quite foolishly, makes those trips. Now, I do not stride off that airplane in Chicago going, hey there, top negotiator from the East, ready to take over. In fact, to be honest with you, it's about as good as I ever look. As it is apparent to many of you in this room, I am not a big believer in dressing for success. Because I've never gone in a situation where people are saying, no, absolutely no, forget it, and you walk in. You know, and they go, hey, I love the way that guy's put together. The matching ensemble, the cut and fabric of that garment, the power ties. See, I was thinking no, but based on his clothing, make that yes. No, indeed the opposite may be true. If somehow you look that good, they expect you to make the concessions. And so my strategy in negotiations is generally to make the other side feel superior to me. many cases you have to work very hard. But nevertheless, it tends to pay off. See, what negotiating tends to be all about, it's a cross-cultural phenomenon. Every time you're interacting with someone, you're dealing with someone who doesn't see this situation the way you do. It's like you're dealing with someone from another culture or really another world. In reality, we don't see things as they are. Each of us see things as we are. We are captives of the pictures in our brain. So even in this room, there's not one reality. There's many realities as there are people. Because if there was anybody here exactly like you, there'd be no reason for you to be here. And so, what essentially you're trying to do in negotiations, what you're trying to do in selling and persuading, is get into the other side's world. Try to figure out his or her perception. Try to understand what their problems are. And then, once you do this, you come up or help them come up with solutions to meet their needs and your needs. That's essentially what you're doing. See, years ago, some of you from marketing, and many years ago I had a job while I was going to school, I was selling life insurance. You know, I needed a job. And they told you how to do this. You know, you were supposed to control the discussion, you know, do all the talking. Then they gave you ways of overcoming the other side's objective, closing techniques where you spoke all the time. Today we know that that is ineffective in selling, that is ineffective in persuading. Today we understand what you've got to do is really listen louder to the other side and probe deeper. So that means that as you interact with people, if you want to persuade them, if you want to negotiate effectively, you've got to really change your listen-talk ratio and your question-and-answer ratio. You ask questions when you think you know the answers. You actively listen to the other side, and you convey to the other side that you're listening. Now, how do you do that? You look at them, you know, and they speak. You nod at the appropriate time, all right? You take notes. You actually write down what they're saying, even if what they're saying is junk. You know, it's meaningless stuff. You still write it down. Why? Because they like when you write down what they say. See, how do they know you have respect for them? You're writing down what they say, and then you read it back to them. Well, let me make sure I got this right. See? And by the way, you never have it right. You've always mischaracterized something, and you left something out. But you change what you have until they're satisfied, and then you go on. Also, you don't spend time arguing, debating, and explaining to the other side where they're wrong, foolish, stupid, or misinformed. See, why don't you do that? Because assuming you're right, sometimes there are other people there. You get involved with face sense, and then you're asking this person who's just been humiliated and shown why he's wrong and misinformed to now make a decision. Yes, I want to enter into a continuing relationship with this guy where quarterly I'm humiliated in this fashion. See, that doesn't help, you know, facilitate this person moving from no to yes, which is what negotiation is all about, moving from reluctance to commitment. Another thing you want to do is you want to try to show empathy for the other side's point of view. You want to be less opinionated and less judgmental. You know, all of us have opinions about things, but you try to withhold judgment and bias. And if you can do that, you stand a better chance of moving this person from no to yes and from reluctance to commitment. And that's really what you're trying to do. Try to get into their world. Let me give you an example of this. About 2 years ago, a group called the Tupac Amaru took over the Japanese embassy in Lima, Peru. Some of you may remember this episode. Originally, they were holding 186 hostages. And I get this call to go to the National Security Council, and I went over there. You know, I was talking with the National Security Advisor about this. And he wants me to go to Lima, Peru. He set up a meeting with Alberto Fujimori, who's the president. And my job is to try to explain to him why it's not a good idea to immediately rush the building. Primarily, my credentials why it helped set up the FBI's hostage negotiating program. So I fly down there, you know, nice flight. I didn't even go through customs, cars waiting for me. And I go to the presidential palace where I actually met with the president, Alberto Fujimori, who gives me a cup of tepid tea and a cracker, you know, on a plate. And I remember looking around for something to put on the cracker. You know, it shows you where I'm coming from. These are my primary needs. Immediately, he says, well, he really isn't the person to talk to. The people that are to talk to are the military people. And the door swings open, and three military guys walk in. Actually, they don't walk in. They sort of like march in. And they have their hats on, and they got this fruit salad on their cap, and they got medals hanging from their neck, and they got ribbons down both sides of their jacket, which I'm not used to. The American Army will only do one side. These guys have both sides. And I'm thinking, did I miss a big war down here? These got to be the bravest guys I've ever been with, you know? So I'm trying to explain to them, you know, that their current strategy, you know, which was digging a tunnel under the embassy and overflying the building to provoke the hostage takers is going to result in a lot of, you know, lost lives of hostages. But I'm really getting nowhere with these guys. You know, I'm trying to give them other examples that occurred throughout the world where time works in our favor. We got the building surrounded. They're not going anywhere. And one of them, who is like the leader of the pack, a guy by the name of Hernandez, says, look, I come from a town of 93 people. You know, he tells me where it is in Peru. Once a boy, 8-year-old boy, he took a dog. It was not his dog. And he took a dog into a shack. And the shack was made of wood and straw. And we surround the shack. We give him seven. We count to seven to come out. I'm thinking, why seven? You know? What about the good old American three? You know, one, two, three. I'm figuring, well, it's a slower culture here. You know, we count to seven. And if the dog is not released and the boy come out, we do something drastic. And they don't come out, you know. So we burned the building down. Then the dog came out, not the boy. I'm thinking, what the hell does that mean, you know? I'm thinking, I'm hanging around with these people. These are morons, you know? I'm just, by association alone, I'm losing brain tissue. My IQ is dropping precipitously. So at the beginning, I'm like trying to give them arguments and show them where they're wrong, where that won't work. And then I realize, you know, this is not working with these guys. So I remember saying to them, you know, I think I understand what you're saying. I don't have that experience with the kid in the shack with the dog. You know? But based upon my own narrow and parochial experience, you know, here's the way I see it. And would you believe that kind of worked? And they waited like 60 days before they actually rushed the building. But by this time, you see, time had worked and we had intelligence. And so, you know, although they killed all the hostage takers, which they were going to do, you know, no matter what happened, they believe, you know, in, you know, trials there, of course. You got six judges for the whole country. But ultimately, virtually all the lives of the hostages were saved. All right, let me give you another example, because it was mentioned in my introduction about the Iran hostage crisis. It's now just 20 years since the seizure of the American embassy in Tehran, where 53, then 52 Americans were held captive against their will in violation of international law. And I got a call to go to the White House and then to Camp David to meet with President Carter, Secretary of State Vance, and Deputy Secretary of State Warren Christopher at the time. And I got this call because I spent about 7 years in Iran involved in all sorts of commercial dealings. I knew something about Persian history and culture. I even knew a great deal about Islam and Shiism. And my job is to explain to them how to negotiate with the Iranian mullahs. So one of the first meetings we have, I'm sitting around and I'm telling President Carter that, you know, they don't see this the way we do. See, because our approach is highly legalistic. We're saying things like, this is a breach of international law. Is a violation of diplomatic tradition. And I tell them this has no impact upon the Iranian mentality. They see this as having 53 hot rugs for sale and are trying to get as much as they can for their illegally obtained merchandise. And so when President Carter walks into the rug seller's bazaar and says, I need the hostages, I want them, they're the centerpiece of my foreign policy. And if I don't get them back immediately, I won't campaign against Teddy Kennedy. Imagine the impact upon the mullahs. What do they care, Teddy? You know, you understand? See, in fact, the impact is negative by creating more demand, by wanting it so much. With the supply of hostages limited, the price is going up. So unintentionally, I tell him he's prolonging the captivity of the hostages. And Carter cut me off. He said, Herb, you don't understand. You, myself, and the mullahs, we all from the same Abrahamic tradition. I didn't even know what the hell he was talking about. And I kind of figured out that he and I may have been from that tradition, but not the mullahs. And so I'm sort of like going on, trying to show them, look, we're dealing with people who are coming from a different place. See, I say, look, how do Americans feel about negotiations? Americans don't even like the word. We call it bargaining, haggling, chiseling. My wife has even said to me on many occasions, I do not lie for money. You know, the implication is that I do. But the Iranians come from a bargaining culture. They bargain everything. I mean, think of your own life's experience. Have any of you in this room ever purchased a Persian rug retail? I mean, even if you wanted to, they wouldn't let you. It would be a cultural sin. So everything is bargain, and we're reluctant to bargain. How do Americans make the largest single purchase that they make in their life, which is probably a home? Even if it's a tract home in a development area, we sort of like look for a sign in the sky. You know, it's up there, 150 feet, and the sign will say $197,226. You know, and that's what we're paying. Even if we're getting screwed at that price, we don't care. Everybody's getting screwed at that price. That is the American way, equality of screwing right across the board. And we make that purchase, by the way, fast. Why? Because time is money. You know what I mean? In and out, quick. How about the Iranians? They bargain everything, and by virtue of the fact you're a mullah, you're unemployed. Other than your big obligatory prayers five times a day, the rest of the day you're looking to kill time. So we're coming from a different place. Now, I tried to explain this to President Carter. He cut me short again. He says, Herb, Ayatollah Khomeini. He always called him Khomeini. It was like he knew Farsi and I didn't. Ayatollah Khomeini is not like you and I. Ayatollah Khomeini is a martyr. He wants to die. He don't care about his own life. And I remember saying to him at the time, how old is Khomeini? And Carter knew that stuff. He knew details. He said,
86 years and 8 months.
I said, look, how can you have an 86-year-old martyr? The life expectancy of a martyr is 16.2 years. When you get in your 20s or 30s, you really need another career. And so I would come home from those encounters, walk into my house, so where I'm greeted by my wife, who's an upbeat, optimistic person, and she'd say, hey, how'd it go? I remember saying to her at the time, we have any U.S. savings bonds? Sell. Now, the point I'm trying to make, and that I'm trying to belabor, actually, is that one of the things you want to try to do is get into the world of the other side. And if you can do that, you're really ahead of the game. Say, effective selling today is you don't sell products, you don't sell services per se. What you do is, or even ideas or proposals when you're in the corporate or organizational world, what you try to do is find out what the other side's underlying concerns, interests, and needs are, what their problems are, what their priorities are, what their pressures are, and you help them to solve their problems. That's what effective negotiators do really today. So in your classes, you say, if you're negotiating, and I understand you have exercises, let's say involving a house or some commodity of sorts, and one person says, I want $10,000, that's my demand. And the other says, responds with, I give you four. You already have a gap. So you already have the potential for winners and losers and competitive outcomes. Now, how do you deal with that in the real world? When they say, I want 10, they demand, you say, how'd you come up with that? I don't understand how you could say that. Can you give me some explanation? What is that based on? See, if you're going to do that, you're going to get out more information and you're going to broaden the gauge for negotiation. By the way, what is the most difficult thing to negotiate in the entire world? A single issue item. We only talk about one damn thing. And the single issue item is a zero sum item because you produce a winner and a loser. So you put $100 on the table and I put $100 on the table, okay? We have a nice discussion. You stand up with $120. Ask me if I'm happy. I'm happy till I count. You understand? He got $20 of mine. See, I don't care how you smooth that over. As long as I can count, I know I lost in that particular situation. So that's what I'm saying to you. When you go out and negotiate, what you got to do is try to broaden the gauge. Find more things to talk about. The more stuff you can talk about, the more you can achieve outcomes where both sides feel that they benefited, feel that they gain, and they legitimately benefit and legitimately gain. Why? Because human beings are complex, complicated. They're multifaceted. They tend to verbalize one thing because that verbalization is acceptable in our culture. But people want a hell of a lot of things, and some things they don't even know they want until you interact with them. Then they're, hey, I could get that. Yeah, I didn't know. But if you help them solve problems, you're way ahead of the game. Now, this game of negotiation I'm talking about has been around from time immemorial. People have been playing this game. It is an ancient and ageless phenomenon. If you were to look at the earliest religious texts, they are replete with anecdotes involving negotiation. Early on in the Bible, there's an encounter in the Old Testament between Abraham and the Lord. Some of you may recall this episode. The Lord advised Abraham he intends to destroy the twin cities. In other words, Sodom and Gomorrah must go. We know from what occurs subsequently that Abraham does not buy into the Lord's solution. Abraham is now in a rather precarious, tenuous position. Why? He's being asked to negotiate with the Almighty. So I call this operating from a position of less leverage. Whenever anyone says to you, hey, get out there and negotiate with the Almighty, it doesn't take a lot to figure that the power may be on the other side. Now, it is instructive, at least to me, how Abraham goes about this task. Does he say to the Lord, look, I was thinking about what you were saying. Overall, another outstanding judgment on your part, as I knew it would be. Okay? Or does he say, you know, I kind of disagree with the whole thing. You know what I mean? No. He says the former. You know, I was thinking about an outstanding judgment on your part. However, a question kind of like popped up into my head. I was just wondering, what if we were to come up with 50 good and decent people there, you know, amidst all the evil and corrupt? Do you think it would be right to kill the 50 good with all the evil? Just asking. And the Lord responds, why? Because all negotiations involve action, reaction. See, think of your own experience. You make a proposal to someone, what do? They come back with a counter proposal. There is a demand followed by an offer. There's an asking price followed by a bid. Occasionally, you may make a proposal to one of the faculty. You want to turn in a paper late, okay? And they don't even respond. See, but we all know not to respond is a response. Why? Because this game I'm talking about is a paradoxical game. It is an enigma. It is a conundrum where things on its face make absolutely no sense, yet on an underlying level, somehow it does. It's like O'Hare Airport, you know, where more planes land than take off. A lot of us don't understand. It's like, what do you say to God when he sneezes? Presumably a paradox of sorts. Now, in this example that I give you, Abraham throws out a proposal to the Lord. Well, what if I come up with 50 good and decent people? The Lord immediately responds, Abraham, get the 50 and we'll spare all of Sodom and Gomorrah. Back to Abraham. Well, I really didn't do a count. I'm not sure how many there are. I could be five short. How'd you feel about 45? Lord says, no problem. We'll go up to 45. Back to Abraham. I'm speaking figuratively. I may only have 25. Lord says, fine, we'll go to 25. And the Bible explains to us how Abraham gets the Lord down to 10, which I personally feel is damn good negotiating. Now, The only problem is the guy can't come up with the 10. But I figure, hey, that's an entirely different question. Now, why do I use this example? Well, I've got a couple purposes of mine. One, to point out to you, to all of you, that you know a hell of a lot about negotiations. I say that because all of you were once children. You observe children. Children somehow know how to negotiate. There are little people in a big person's world. They are people without formal power or authority, yet they seem to get their personal wishes fulfilled, whether it's getting a new toy or Pokemon or whatever nonsense they're into nowadays. How do children achieve this? Number one, they set very high goals, personal goals. They are unrealistic goals. They aim high. And it is true in life and in negotiation. If you expect more, you tend to get more. Wernher von Braun, the German rocket scientist who later worked with NASA, wrote an autobiography which was titled Aim for the Stars. The man never hit the stars once. Hit London a hell of a lot. But nevertheless, it tended to pull up his performance. The second thing that kids tend to do is kids understand the decision-making process within their own organization. They know who makes the decisions, and they can read the cues because they're in such proximity to a mother and father. And so when a child goes to a mother and gets rejected, it doesn't stop. It goes to the father. When both of them are united against the child doesn't stop. The kid appeals it to the grandparents. So this is constantly going on. Kids, as we know, have considerable amount of energy. They're inexhaustible. They wear you down. They persist and they persevere. Very good qualities to have if you're a negotiator. My wife and I, we are the parents of three children. Our oldest child, our daughter, I remember we had standards for her and insisted she live up to those standards. Second child, we still had the standards, but we had many, many more exceptions. Third child, we're tired people. You understand? Invariably, we say to him, why don't you ask your brother and sister? You know, leave us alone. We've been through this already. So I'm saying to you, look, those things that you knew as a kid apply to these situations that you encounter, whether it's looking for a job, whether it's moving up your organization, whether it's being involved in procurement or organizational behavior, you can conceptualize and apply it to these situations. See, the setting is different, the cast of characters are different, but it's really the same. The second major point I want to make is one of the reasons we do poorly in negotiations, we accept the way the other side has framed an issue or formulated a problem. See, people will say to you, look, you want my business or don't you want my business? Is this a go or no-go situation? They say to you, take it or leave it. You want A or B. See, we evaluate this. We evaluate A. A is good for us. We like A. B is terrible for us. You know? A is good. B is terrible. Well, I'll take good. No, but we look at it again. A is poor. Poor. A is poor. B is terrible. I now got a choice to make. What the hell am I going to pick? I'm going with poor because poor is better than terrible. But it never in life is it between A or B. There's always a C in there. There's a J. There's an omega. There's a number 32. So even you know that an ultimatum, which appears on its face to be a twofold choice, you know, you take it or leave it, you all know it's not a twofold choice. Because you can take it, you can leave it, or what else you can do? You come up with another proposal. Now, why do we get caught in that rut so much? Because I suspect that many of you have been raised in North America. You've been subjected to grade school in North America. And if you are, you learn how teachers evaluate bright students. Bright students are recognized one of two ways. When the teacher asks a question, they know the answer. Or when the teacher asks a question, they get their hand up first. So speed of response is very important in this culture. But the opposite is true in negotiation. In negotiations, dumb is better than smart. Inarticulate is better than articulate. And you actually want to train yourself to say, I don't know. I didn't understand. What'd you say? Where are we? What the hell is going on? See, teach yourself not to respond so quickly, to dwell amidst ambiguity, to live with uncertainty. Don't clarify things that quickly. Don't frame things that quickly. Just kind of like stagger along. One of the two reasons why we do poorly in a negotiation is we have too much authority. Okay, the second reason is we're too emotionally involved. This is me, what are you kidding? It's not like just, you know, for the company, it's my lead. You know? That's why we don't do well with kids, they're our kids, you know. So that's one reason. Second reason was you have too much authority. So it's always a good idea to limit your own authority, even when you have total authority. See, someone says, well, what's your decision? It's a complicated deal. Come on, I agreed, what about you? Always say, let me speak to my fill in the blank, my wife. Even if you're not married, you say, I want to talk to my wife. I want to talk to our board of directors. I got to check with our banker. You understand? I'm saying it. Slow down. Delay. Use time. Get in the habit of answering questions with questions. If you were me, what would you do? No matter what they say, you're not in trouble because you always come back with, well, too bad you're not me. You are now back to where you were. Ask the other side for help. You know, can you help me on this? People respond to that more than you realize. I need your help. You're so much more experienced. Okay? This is the best thing you got going with you. You get out into the corporate world, you will be a younger person. There are tremendous advantages in being a younger person because every person is older than you.
You say to them,
you've been here. You're so much more experienced than me. It's actually truthful, you know? I say that to people when I know it's not true. It is a moron. But you say to this person, you can be truthful and credible. Can you help me on this? By the way, and people will help you. Let me share with you the magic words of negotiations. Words I trust you'll take out of here and make part of your negotiating vocabulary. These are we words, little words, both the three letters. First one is spelled H-U-H and is pronounced, huh? You say that a lot, huh? Huh? Second word, W-H-A, there's no T on this, and it's pronounced, wah. And you integrate the two, huh, wah, huh. Instantly, you're going to be more effective in every one of your negotiable relationships. As some of you may feel, this is rather primitive stuff. I'm getting an MBA degree, so I could be a little bit more sophisticated, above the people. I'm not going to go around in my career grunting, huh, and wah. For those of you who feel that way, I will give you a slightly more sophisticated strategy. When the other side seems to demand an immediate response, identify with a pen in your pocket. I've had this jacket on now for probably 4 hours. One of the first things I did was I put a pen in the pocket. If I were to identify with this pen, I know it is dark in the pocket. It is humid in the pocket. It is warm in this pocket. Even odors coming from this pocket. And so they want an immediate answer. I look in my pocket. I identify with my pen. I take out my pen. I hold it up in the air. I pull off the cap. I move it around somewhat. I blow on the tip, thereby aerating it somewhat. I put the cap back on the pocket, put the cap back on, put the pen back in the pocket, turn to the other side and say, where were we? This is helpful stuff, right? Third major point I want to make this evening probably should deal with value. What is the value of anything? The value of anything is what people are willing to pay for it, okay? Simply. In fact, I think you have my book. It's the one thing I remember saying in my book. And that's the truth. If you could look at every negotiation, no matter how technical and complex it is, and in your mind put it in terms of buy and sell, as far as value is concerned, you're really way ahead of the game. You ask people in this world, what is the value of your home? You know what they do? They pay off the amount of square feet, okay? And they multiply it by this magic number that keeps going up. And it always goes up, you know, real estate. Or they say, well, other homes in the area are going for. Or they say, well, you look at the replacement cost in the back of my insurance policy. That's the value. Yeah, have a loss and you'd be negotiating like crazy to get anything near that. Those are all guides to value. The value of your home, the value of anything, is what people are willing to pay for it. Therefore, what I do try to do is say, if I'm selling something, I generate as much competition as I can for what I'm selling. Also, what I try to do is I differentiate what I'm selling from everything else, okay? And then when I'm buying something, see, I see myself as selling money. The more people that want money, the further my money would go. Now, it's my understanding you have speakers in here. Periodically, people tell you how to evaluate businesses and things like that. But they tell you how to do it like a CPA, like an accountant, based on the numbers. What's the revenue? What's the cash flow? And all of that are great guides to value. But people are complex human beings. They buy something, they sell something for a lot of reasons. You understand? And if you could figure this out, you get an edge. You get a tremendous edge in all negotiation. Many years ago, Citibank, well, this is like 25 years ago, I was working for them. They saw themselves narrowly, you know, as being in the business of selling money. Now, which was a mistake. They should have been in the business of renting money, which means they got a better chance of getting it back. Unless they were renting it to South American countries who didn't seem to care that much at the time. But if they see themselves, say, as selling or renting even money, and all I got is money, and their money is the same as their competition's money, then people like me can destroy their profit margin. See, I used to do this all the time. You know, I go into Citibank, I say, look, here's all my stuff, my financial stuff. Give me the best rate. I need a loan. You know, best rate. And the guy will give me his best rate. I say, you sure this is the best rate? The best rate. He give me the best rate. The absolute, okay? Yeah. I say, look, I'm going across the street, you know, and if I get a better rate, I'm going to come back, you know? All right? He understands this is the best rate. I do go across the street, just like I say. I tell him, look, I just came from Citibank. By the way, this is very complex things you're doing, right? I just came from Citibank. Here's their best rate. Will you beat it? The guy will beat it. He will beat it. He will beat it. I said, maybe I'll be back. I don't know. Go back to Citibank. I was across the street, okay? And this is what your competition said. They'll go lower than you. Will you beat that? The guy goes lower. He goes lower. Now, what do? I said, I may be back. I don't go to see him anymore. I walk around the block. I come back, and I say, do I have to tell you where I've been? Now, who's this guy competing against? Himself. You understand? He's competing against himself. And why is it so difficult? Because the two things are the same. See, the money is the same. Now, what Citibank did, they smartened up. They did was they changed the shape of what they were offering, what they were selling. They added services to it. They added value to it. So you couldn't compare what Citibank had with their competition. And then they could charge more for it. People weren't able to measure. And I'm saying to you, if you can differentiate one item from another, and by the way, negotiating, you're not just talking about services or products that you're negotiating. You are the person that they trust. You're the person that they come back to. You make yourself unique, make yourself different, do things that no one else does, go against the grain. You're giving enhanced value to doing business with you. Indeed, as I've always believed, a nose that can hear is worth two that could smell. I don't even know what the hell that means, but I always say that and I believe that. Probably one of the most important things in negotiation tends to be your unique style. See, I simply break down negotiations into how and what. How you negotiate is your style, your demeanor, your manner, your way as you approach the other side. What is the content of this transaction, the specific terms that are very measurable? And I'm saying to you, that your how, your style resonates more than the what. The singer, you're the singer. You count for more than the song. The player, you're the player, counts for more than the plays. All of you know this because you've been probably in a situation where someone said things to you that were a little extreme. I used to go to staff meetings when I was in the corporate world, and people would, you know, come down with spreadsheets and tell us why we were messing up, and they didn't even know what they were talking about, you know, the guys with the green eye shades. And I felt like telling them off, but I remembered I had a mortgage and a family, you know. So I would mask the primitive urge at retribution, you know. I would don my executive facade, I'd get out of there, and go back to my office where I would share this with someone I could trust. Or better yet, I wait till I get home where I could really trust someone. And now I'm burdening myself to my life's companion, my partner. I'm sharing with her what happened. I'm pouring out my heart to her. And, you know, and the woman says things like, well, that's the way life is. They never promised you a rose garden. It was that moment I realized, you know, the woman had to be of Greek descent, because she was always like very philosophical about my problems. So I would tell it to her again. Put that down. I'll tell you one more time. I would tell it to her again. And as I'm telling it to her again, I'm listening myself. It don't even sound that bad to me. You know, and then I would always say to her, it's not what they said, it's the way or how they said it. If you would have been there, you'd understand. Now, why am I having such difficulty communicating with someone presumably who's close to me? Because it's very hard to verbalize the how. Saying the how is what bothered me. We come from a culture of quantification, a culture of measurement, where people focus on the bottom line, a culture where we want specificity. And because the how is hard to measure, it can't be specified, we ignore it. But I'm saying to you, your how, as you deal with people, has an enormous impact on moving the other side. It resonates. It vibrates more than you even realize. Let me give you one specific example. It's someone I worked for a year and a half and attended all sorts of meetings with him. And that was some person I came to regard as the most popular president of my lifetime. In fact, he's the only president who has become even more popular since he left office. And I'm referring to Ronald Reagan. And the question is, what makes Reagan so popular? Do you believe for one moment it was his policies and programs? Are you kidding me? We're not even sure what they were. Reagan was popular primarily because of his style. And what was his style? Reagan's style was the quintessential American style. He embodied characteristics that were very American. He played them to his constituency, the American people. See, and so he really got a perfect mesh. Now, why do I say this? I say this because 170 years ago, a French sociologist by the name of de Tocqueville came to this country, traveled about, met Americans, interviewed them, took extensive notes, went back to France, where he proceeded to write books in which he explained us to ourselves. Now, how come he could explain me to me? Why haven't I been able to figure me out? Because it's hard for me to know me. See, in trying to get to me, know me, I got to look at me through me, which creates distortions. That's why we often say it takes two to see one. Or as I would say, does the fish know it's in the water? You ever wonder about that? Presumably not. But I'm obsessed with this. I'm constantly watching fish swim through water. Fish are very graceful, you know. They move through that water. And then the fish makes its last move, its last mistake. It lunges for food, which we term bait, because the food is always impaled on a hook. So the fish will not just get the food, I'll get the hook. And I am with a child that is mercilessly reeling up this fish. And all fish, when they break through the water, their behavior, their demeanor is the same. Their body is contorted. Their eyes bulge. Their head moves back and forth. Their mouth goes open and closed as if to say, what the hell? I was in the water. Now, what did they think? Blurred vision was a norm? And so, it's hard for me to know myself. See, it takes a third party to tell us about ourselves. And what did de Tocqueville tell us about Americans? He said, Americans have three characteristics that he did not find among other people in this world. Americans, number one, like things simply put. Americans believe in right and wrong, for me, against me, friend or foe. Americans do not want to understand nuances, gradations, or subtleties. About 7 years ago, I was on Nightline with Ted Koppel, and he asked me that I think the United States would be sending ground troops to fight in Bosnia-Herzegovina. I said, absolutely not. He said, how could you be so categorical in that response? I said, two reasons. Number one, Americans don't know geography. See, we didn't even know where Yugoslavia is. How are we going to know what Bosnia Herzegovina is? Number two, that is a three-party struggle. We don't do three-party struggles here. We do two-party struggles, the good guys against the bad, and we like to believe we're allied with the good against the bad. Now, why are we this way? It's our history. It's our tradition. It's our culture. It's our geography. It's our political system. It's even our mythology. And indeed, the motion pictures have kind of reinforced that thinking. And I would remind you that the motion pictures of today are not the pictures that Ronald Reagan and I saw when we grew up. Before we went to the movie, in my day, we knew the damn movie. John Wayne was the same guy in every movie. Gary Cooper was the same guy, essentially. One year, he made 12 motion pictures. People were amazed. How could he memorize all that dialogue? His dialogue was the same. Yup, nope, same stuff, every movie. But today, things are different. Meryl Streep is unrecognizable by me. That woman is a human chameleon. She changes from role to role. Robert De Niro expands and contracts before your eyes. Dustin Hoffman, Robin Williams, you don't even know gender. But Reagan, see, is a product of my time. Reagan looks at the world simply and is a master at framing issues. I don't know if any of you remember the air traffic controller strike, the PATCO strike. At the time, I received a call from the head of that union, a fellow by the name of Robert Poli, who asked me, how long did I think the strike would last? I said, probably forever. He said, no, you don't understand. We didn't go out yet. I said, that's what I'm trying to tell you to do. Don't go. And the reason I said this was these guys made every possible mistake that could be made in that situation. They had every rut on that road. The only way to do that was to double back. And the single biggest mistake they made was they let Reagan frame the issue. And Reagan's good at this. He asked the American people, is it okay for a government employee to violate a sacred oath to strike against the interests of all Americans in violation of the law of the land? Huh? How the hell is anybody going to win on that issue? The man has wrapped himself in the American flag, apple pie, and a hot lunch for orphans. And from that moment on, PATCO is perceived as a greedy kamikaze union. And for people who are presumably experts in collision avoidance, they didn't understand how to apply it to the collective bargaining process. The second thing de Tocqueville told us about Americans is that Americans tend to be the most optimistic people in the entire world. Americans believe is an article of faith that all problems can be solved in our lifetime and all obstacles can be overcome. We are the only country in the history of this world that has ever declared war against poverty. I mean, poverty has been in existence since the beginning of time. Not only did we declare war against, we had a deadline for knocking it off. 3 years. And then presumably we would do something else. Al Smith, the Democratic presidential candidate in 1928, said, Americans don't need umbrellas, we walk in eternal sunshine. 20 years ago, there was a Broadway musical that some of you may recall. The musical is called Annie. The popular song from Annie was called Tomorrow and had these lyrics. The sun will come up tomorrow, bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow there'll be sun. That record sold 4.8 million copies in North America, despite the fact that it had no beat. Total overseas sales for that song, 19. Had no idea what the hell that was. That is a very American song. See, this is the big mistake that Jimmy Carter made midterm in his presidency. He decided we were going through a malaise period. And he took political advice probably from Howard Cosell or someone, because he decided to tell it like it is. See, he came down from the mountain and he told it like it is to the American people. He said, look, your future's behind you. You're going to be the first generation whose standard of living will be lower than that of your parents. As far as owning your own home is concerned, forget it. It's impossible because interest rates are out of control. There are so many variables, we can't even get a handle on this. As far as sending your kids to higher education, you know, beyond high school, the likelihood is that it won't happen because the costs will be prohibitive. So vote for me. This is not a good approach with this constituency. See, Reagan, on the other hand, for 8 years, the man was ebullient. The man was optimistic. The man was congenial. The man was self-assured. The man was enthusiastic. The man was happy, and realistically, the man never had a right to feel that good. See, why do I say that? 2.5 months in the office is an assassination attempt. They almost killed him. His wife, whom he loves dearly, had a mastectomy. Members of her family that he was very close to died off while he was in office. Reagan also had cancer in various parts of the body. He used to go in monthly to a hospital. They sniff off a little piece of his nose. And he also has the four most disappointing children you could wish on any parent. Now, despite all of that, Reagan was always upbeat and enthusiastic. I know that because in those days, I used to work a lot in Western Europe. By the way, this is before the proliferation of CNN, which meant that when I was in Europe, you know, whether it was France or Germany or England, I would be starving for sports news. I'd be starving for national news. So I tried to get home on Friday, take the flight, which would bring me home in time to get the network news, and I usually did. And I'd arrive home, I'd turn on my set on Friday, and every Friday, the national news started the same way. No matter what was going on in the world, good, bad, or indifferent, it opened with a shot of Ronald Reagan going to a helicopter. I never knew where the helicopter went, but he'd be going to a helicopter. He'd turn on the set, and there he was. He'd be smiling. He'd be happy. He'd be waving. He'd be moving toward the helicopter. A man with a very old face and very young miracle hair. And he was always followed by a woman being pulled by a dog. Then he would stop short of the helicopter to take a question from the omnipresent Sam Donaldson, who I personally felt was chained to him. Now, how did you know it was Sam Donaldson? Reagan would tell you. He'd go, "What is it, Sam?" No one saw Sam. No one heard Sam. And it was a miracle that Reagan could hear Sam, because Reagan at the time was wearing a double hearing aid. The man could not hear, which, by the way, may have accounted for his congeniality. He'd go, "Yes, what is it, Sam?" And he'd pause. And wait, and then he'd start to answer a question and no one ever heard. In the midst of the response, the helicopter blades go on. And this somehow gave his constituency, the American people, this feeling that problems were being dealt with and leadership was being exercised. The third thing de Tocqueville told us about America is that America has always been a populist nation, certainly since the time of Andrew Jackson. Americans do not like people in central government. We do not like people in Washington. They may have been all right before they got there, but once they're there, we believe they change. They become dogmatic, dogdactic. They become patronizing, condescending. They become experts, and we don't like experts here, because experts are people who know more and more about less and less till they eventually know everything about nothing. We like regular people in this country, people that mess up as long as they own up to messing up. No one understood this better than Ronald Reagan. See, if you think for a moment, what did he claim to have as his area of expertise? Nothing, I tell you, nothing. Only he claimed to be a person of convictions. Americans like people with convictions, even if they're wrong on some convictions. We say, well, he believes it, or she believes it, as a matter of conscience. But there was a time when Ronald Reagan was in big trouble, when the Iran-Contra affair hit. I was in the Beltway at the time. And the print media, especially, really let him have it. The Washington Post led the charge. They said, okay, we got him now. The Teflon presidency is at an end. There's only one or two possibilities. Number one, the man is actively involved, orchestrating criminality. Once again, we got a president who's a crook. Or number two, the man is a moron, a nitwit, a nincompoop. He's unaware of what is even going around here. And we waited for Reagan to choose between those two. And Reagan didn't. He just kept walking around like he's in a time warp. Then the media cornered him. He appointed the Tower Commission to look into this matter. And that got him time. And then the Democratic-controlled Congress made a political mistake. They preempted the field. They co-opted the situation. They appointed this committee headed up by Senator Inouye to look into this matter. And Senator Inouye's committee did a thorough investigation. They subpoenaed documents, records, witnesses. They held public hearings, and 14 months later, they came up with their report. And their report was very disparaging of Reagan. It was pejorative. And I remember pressure being built on Reagan to go on the air, to take TV time. And sure enough, I heard that he did. I was excited. I ran out. I bought 21 pads of paper, 66 sharpened pencils. I knew this would be a historic speech. I remember sitting in front of my TV set and watching him come out. He walks out, does that hallway walk which he invented, builds up suspense as he gets to the podium, and then he doesn't seem to be talking to the people in the room, but he's speaking over their heads to his constituency across this vast nation. And he said, "I don't know. I don't remember. I didn't know what I knew, and I forgot. Or maybe I never even knew." How do people react to that? People didn't even get upset. They said, "Well, you can't know everything." I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on. Give the guy a break. He's getting kind of old. See, what Reagan did was he hit on an old American cliche, an old American chestnut. This was still the land of opportunity. And anyone could be president around here. You got hope, you know? And so I'm saying to you that Reagan, based upon really his style, his approach, did a long way toward achieving his objectives. Now, I'm not talking about President Reagan, of course. I'm talking about you and myself. You, as I said, are unique people. You have a unique approach. There are certain things you're comfortable with, you can carry off. It is always a good idea to be yourself, because you can be the best you can be. Now, do you change? Sure, you change over a period of time. But I'm saying to you, if you start negotiations off in a reasonable way, in a congenial way, with a low-key pose of calculated incompetence, displaying some sort of humility to the other side, that's the best thing for all of us. And always try to be authentic, and always try to be yourself. Now, why? Why do I say this? Because I'm a soft humanitarian? No. People would not describe me that way. Because it's always easy to go from soft to tough. It's always easier to go from cooperative to competitive. See, but it's very hard to start out competitive, adversarial, give ultimatums, and then try to get back. Look, you son of a... I'm going to tell you right now, you'll do this the way I say, or I'll do my best to destroy you and your career. Gee, I guess I came on a bit strong. Perhaps I misspoke a word or two. You destroy all credibility. So, see, what you got to do is practice gradualism, start off slow, and the reality is that 75-80% of the time, people will respond, especially in this culture, because people believe in the reciprocity norm, because they've been told by mothers like I had. My mother always told me when I was a little boy, "Herbert, if you be nice to people, they'll be nice to you." She should have qualified that by saying about 85% of the time. But nevertheless, it does work out 85% of the time. Now, negotiating tends to be a mixed motive game, as you know. You know this, right? All negotiations involve commonality and conflict. You can't have one without the other. As the greatest living philosopher of our time, Lily Tomlin, once said, "We're all in this together by ourselves." And as usual, she got it right. So that gives us a question. If all negotiations involve commonality and conflict, what do you start negotiating first, commonality or conflict? Commonality. I don't care what the situation is. You always open up talking about what's in the paper. You know, events of the day. What happened to Penn State? You know, whatever. You know, what do you think they're going to do this week? What's the weather like? How are you doing? How's your family? Let me tell how I felt this morning. All right? Then you tackle the smallest possible issue, the thing that you can think they'll agree to, something that's not emotional, something that's easy. You deal with easy issues, many easy issues you can. And you save for the very end the zero-sum issue, the fixed-sum issues, with things that can be quantified like rate, price, salary, term. Yeah, anything can be put in a numerical form. And even that stuff, you try to fractionate and splinter. When will the money be paid? What form will the payment take? What if a payment's missed? How will I miss that? See, what you want people to do is you want people to invest in the process. Why? The more people invest, the harder it is to divest. Rats and human beings have this in common. The more energy expended in pursuit of a particular goal, the more desirable that goal becomes. You make two investments. I think I put this in my book. You buy two stocks. You make two investments. One goes up, one goes down. Which one are you more likely to sell first? You sell. People sell the one that went up. Not that they should, they do. How about the one that went down? They hang on to it. They keep it. You know what a lot of us do? We buy more. Why? If the price is good before, hey, look at it now. That is the investment principle. Also, if you mess up in negotiations, and occasionally we mess up, what should you do? You apologize for messing up. You make a how concession. And you do it 100%. Not like Bill Clinton, our leader, did. You know, remember, finally, August 13th, he goes on television. And he says, you know, well, I didn't tell the exact truth. You know, he levels with the American people. And then he says, however, okay? We all know what however means. However means strike that. Forget what I just said. And now people listen. Then he goes on to attack Ken Starr for 20 minutes, which is a mistake. So he had to really, you know, work very hard to do that, to regain trust and credibility after that. I'm saying to you, if you mess up, you apologize 100%. Look, if you're in a relationship with someone, I have been in a relationship with my wife now for 42 years, at least how long I've been married, I assume. Although I travel a lot, so maybe it's only 7 actual years. No, but this is unique nowadays because they run bus tours past my house. But when I was early on in my relationship, when I would mess up, you know, I would be analytical about this. I'd say, look, I believe I was about 72% wrong here. But you contributed. You're about 28%. So if you deal with the question of causation, it would be 72 wrong for me, 28 for you. This did not work, okay? This did not work. Now I know. If I'm going to say I'm wrong, you know what I say? I am 100% wrong. 100%. You 0%. So what I'm saying to you, if you apologize, if you screw up, apologize. Look, we don't, you know, so many deals, if you say, why aren't deals made? Well, they didn't pay enough money. No, that's what they tell you. See, because you'll accept that. If you pay more, you'd make the deal. And you don't, I don't have to explain anything to you because I detest you. You understand? I detest you. I don't like you. I don't trust you. I want you the hell out of my office. I'm going to tell you this. No, this is going to be a whole agonizing encounter. So I say, if you would have paid twice as much, you could have had it. Knowing that I'll get rid of him right away. See? I'm saying deals are not made. Forget why people verbalize it. They're not made because there's something about the other side you don't trust, you don't like, that bothers you, that irritates you. It tends to be, you know, the way they approached you. And so that's why when you negotiate, your approach should be really soft. You don't want to offend the other side. And by the way, if you mess up, if you make a mistake that irritates the other side, and it's usually a how thing, apologize for it. Look, I was at a meeting at Washington a number of years ago, and four of us are supposed to show up at 10 a.m. Three of us come at 10 a.m. We're waiting for the other guy. He arrives at 10:20, and he walks in. Oh, I guess I'm a little late, but I'm actually not that late. My watch says 10:10. We all look at our watches. Our watches say 10:20, you know? He says, however, I'm really not 10 minutes late. Because you told me there'd be parking contiguous to this facility. Needless to say, the lot was closed. I had to drive around the block 3 times. And so when I first passed the lot, it was about 10 minutes to 10. Technically, I'm 10 minutes early. We hated this guy. You understand? It's had nothing to do with the deal. We knew we couldn't do business with this guy. All right? Now, what should he have done? He should have walked in and said, what I did was terrible, horrible. I didn't respect your time. I'm almost 40 minutes late. Please forgive me. Please. What would the other person have said? What the hell are you talking about? Only 20. And there's a guy with a Rolex saying, my watch, you know, 18.22, you know? You understand what I'm saying? See, that's what I call a how concession to the other side. And if you do things like this, really people trust you. They kind of like you. People want to do business with people that they like. All right, let me show you how all of this comes together, and then maybe I'll have time for questions. An experience that many of you have had already and certainly will have. You have bought a car, a new car. I myself do not like to buy cars, but I'm a member of family. When you're a member of family, it creates obligations. My wife will come home, walk in the house, and say to me, Mr. Negotiator. Anyway, this is not a term of endearment to my household. As far as, you know, she's concerned, you know, this is a disparaging remark. She says, Mr. Negotiator, why don't you go out and deal with your people? According to her, my people are used car dealers. But go out and deal with your people and get us a car.
So I try to tell her, I don't know anything about cars. You have to know cars. You know, you need information. You need data. She solved this problem. Her friend bought a car. Her husband and her friend bought a car. She's got the car dealer's card, you know, the salesman's card, and the price the friend's husband paid. I am to walk in with this card, show it to the salesman. He gives me the same car. I know this is not going to work. Nevertheless, she gets me up the next morning, and off I go. I walk in there, walk to the salesman. Yes, it's his card. No, he don't know who wrote that stuff on the back, but he wants to show me the car. Takes me into the showroom. You know, you walk into the showroom, and the cars look nice. They're shined up. And as I approach the car, I become a little nervous because I notice the sticker price. Sticker price always frightens me because it is stuck to the car. So I remember my last experience, how long it took me to scrape that thing off. I know this guy didn't just put this thing on. And the sticker price never says you can have the car for 20,000, you know, flat. $27,411.19. They got it to the penny. And the last two items are state and local taxes. So you feel if I get anything off, the revenue people are after me. I don't know what the hell to do. So I kind of like walk around a car a little bit, you know, rub the hood, open the door, close the door, kick a tire, and the guy drops the price, $3,000. So what do I do? I open the door, close the door, kick a tire, the guy goes down $1,500. So I open the door, close the door, the guy goes down $750. Then he takes $350 out of his own pocket, the bread from his children's mouth, and he gives it to me. And I am moved by that gesture. I take $100 out of my personal allowance, and I give it to him, and now we're only $100 apart. You know? And I think, boy, we're on our way. And suddenly the salesman begins to play the game. See, heretofore had been speaking to me normally, but now he's moving about. His voice also drops somewhat, so I find myself leaning in like my hearing is failing me. He's moving around like he's checking for overhead surveillance, and suddenly he begins to speak to me through the side of his mouth. You ever notice this? When this first happens, I think he's had a stroke. I say, are you all right? Can I get you a glass of water? Why is this man speaking to me through the side of his mouth? He is speaking to me through the side of his mouth because he knows that offers made through the side of the mouth have 27% more credibility than offers made up front. See, this is the world of illusion. This is a damn game here. Hey, then he shows me something only I'm going to get to see because he's so close to me. This is the actual factory invoice price of the car. It is under lock and key. Got a key, opens the drawer. He shows me a printed document. According to this document, every car sold at this price, the dealer will lose $11 a car. I say, well, how can he do that and stay in business? He says, he makes it up in volume. Oh, no. I say, look, I need the other 100. And he says something to me that many of you have heard. He says, I don't have the authority to give you the other 100. I said, who does? Who has the authority? He always points this way. There's a guy back there. There's a salesman upstairs. There's a dealer who lives in a shack adjacent to the billet. Why would he live in a shack? The dealership is six city blocks. He lives there with his dogs. He has three German shepherds and two Doberman pit. Look, I don't care who he lives with. Tell the guy that I'm walking out of here. He's afraid. He don't have enough. Finally, he goes to see the guy in the back. And I wait 5 minutes, 10 minutes. I'm about to walk out when I think I hear dogs barking. No, I can't be. And now the guy returns. When he returns, he don't look the same. He's beaten up. He's limping. His hair is messed up. His tie is askew. He says to me, I spoke to the guy in the back. And the guy in the back says, the best he's going to do is $33. Now, at this point, I have a feeling of deja vu. I know I've got taken by this son of a gun. I want to walk right out of here. Go to the dealer across the street who's selling the same cars. Why don't I do that? Why don't I walk across the street? If I walk across the street, I go back to square number one. I start all over again. I lose my investment. Hey? Second reason I don't walk across the street is as bad as this guy is. You know something? I know how bad he is. There's a certainty principle. Who knows what the guy across the street is living with in the back? Maybe reptiles. Then I have another option. I go home, I see my wife. And she and I form a task force, get some Alpo, some puppy chow. Why waste our time with the salesman? Go over his head, you know? Instead of dealing with the monkey, speak to the organ grinder. Why don't we do this? We do a fast course benefit analysis of the situation. And we say, screw it. And we impose a deadline on ourselves. Now, why does this deal close? Why do car dealers keep using these same damn tactics? Although they claim they don't like it, the public don't like it because they work. And why does it work? Number one, this deal closes because there's sufficient investment. If there's not, you get buyer's or seller's remorse. Number two, there's legitimacy of sort that you can point to. How do people know they got a good deal? See, you compare it to something. Compare it to factory invoice. Look what the hell I got. Compare it to sticker price. Look what I got. Then three, look at the way the concessions were made. By the way, this is a somewhat competitive negotiation. You know, it's not a long-term trusting relationship with a car dealer. It's like a fire hose. You know, the water spurting out, and then less water, and at the end, drip, drip. Look how the concessions were made. First concession is $2,000, whatever it was, $1,000, you know, $350, you know, $100, $33. See, it's near the end. You know, can you do better in negotiation? You can always do better, but you reach a point where it doesn't pay you to do it because the energy, the time expended, it isn't worth it. And last of all, what you've done is you've gotten the other side involved. Just one word that I should tell you about concessions, and that is, if you make a concession to someone, how do they know it's a good concession? You say to this guy, well, you're kicking another $200,000. No problem. What am I thinking? Why didn't I ask for three? You know what I mean? Came too easy. See, how do I know two is good? He got to make me work for that two. He's got to say, I can't give you the two. I'll lose my job for the two. I don't even know if I can give you 100. If I can get you 100, see, he limits his own authority. He got the authority to give me 100. He got the authority to give me 2. If I can get you to 100, would you take that? I don't know. Call the boss right in front of you. Boss, Joe, yeah, look, would you give him 100? Let me ask him. I don't think he'll take that. He said 40. You want 40? No. By the way, Joe's not even here, you know? But Joe don't even... I've worked for bosses. What the hell are you doing? Are you crazy? Are you losing your mind? See, what I'm going to do, when I give this guy the money, whatever it is, he's going to feel he worked for it. He earned that. I sweat it to give him this. That's so we know it's worthwhile. Hey, now, if that's the game, hey, it's the game. It's life. Now, am I talking about relationships which are continuing where there's long-term trust? Everything, almost everything I said that you can forget about. I'm talking about negotiations that are somewhat competitive. And you got to assess the situation. See, when would I give someone says to me, well, what's your best price? When would I give them my best price? If I knew this person, if it was a high level of trust, and I knew he would accept it as the best price, I will give him the best price. But if I don't know this guy and he doesn't know me, I know if I said the best price, he'd go, yeah, okay, give me the real best price. You follow me? So what you've got to do is evaluate the environment that you're working in. Okay, at this point, I have spoken a hell of a lot. In essence, I'm saying to you that you want to view negotiations a hell of a lot of fun. You want to try to make it a satisfying experience. And if you do that, really, you'll be more successful in all of life's negotiations. So at this point, let me throw things open to questions. Any comments that any of you have? Anybody have anything else you'd like to ask me? By anything I've said or have not said? Anything. Come on. Ask me questions.
I got one.
Yes, yeah.
What if the guy on the other side of the table is doing the same dance you are?
It tends to be easier to negotiate. See, in other words, it sounds crazy. The easiest person to negotiate with is a sophisticated, smart person who's really savvy about negotiation. The hardest people to negotiate with, and I told someone this at lunch, the most difficult person to negotiate with is, number one, difficult, crazy people. Number two, irrational people. Number three, dumb people. Okay, dumb. But if you get somebody sophisticated, see, he's doing all of this stuff. Okay, it's not working on you. You do it to him, it's not working. Okay, come on, let's get together. you can cut the deal. The most enjoyable negotiations I've ever had with people are people that were savvy, people that were smart, people that understand. See, they're not vulnerable. You can't do anything to them. They know what you're doing. They're the easiest people to negotiate with. Give me a smart, savvy person every single time. Yeah. Yes, 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 yes.
You said at the beginning that what is important is to care, but not too much.
Yeah.
And walk away. And at the end, you say that what is important is to care and to be smooth and to go with the person. So how do you know when you have to do that? You know, when you have to walk away or to walk inside?
No, I'm saying, look, if I show up, you know, people walk into your office, very often it's happened to me. People call me up. I used to have an office in Northbrook, Illinois, and Northbrook is not on the way to anything, okay? People call up, from downstairs. Oh, Herb, I just happen to be in your neighborhood. I said, where are you going? You know, maybe it's on the way to Waukesha, Wisconsin, you know. I said, where are you going? He said, oh, I was going from Dallas to New York. I thought I'd drop off, you know, say hello. I said, you here to negotiate? No! Everybody who will set up an appointment with you, who will talk to you, is there to negotiate. The only one who is not negotiating is a genuine recluse or a hermit. You know what I mean? If they return your calls, if you can find them, they're negotiating. Now, I'm saying your overall attitude should be about any single deal. I want to make this deal. It's nice if I make this deal, but it is not the end of Western civilization. Okay? You know, I once told General Motors, when they made me an offer, a chintzy, pathetic offer, you know, sad offer. It was a depressingly low offer. I said to them, you know, I was 50 at the time. I'm 50 years of age. And these were all their lawyers, the battery of lawyers, Kirkland and Ellis. You know, in fact, people that later on became famous, you know, independent prosecutors, were at the table. I said, I'm 55 years of age, just like this. And when I look, 50 years of age, when I look back on my life, you know, I think it was a good life. I had low points and high points, you know, but I got better than I deserved. And in 50 years, those 50 years, which are pretty good, I never got an offer from General Motors, you know? It didn't hurt my life. So I think I can go another 20 without an offer. Therefore, I don't want your offer. Now, I actually told them this. You know what they said? Okay, we'll make you an offer. Believe me, that's exactly what happened. Now, people want to do business with people. It's like, you know, Groucho Marx said about country clubs, you know. Why would I want to join a country club that would want me? People want to negotiate with people who somehow don't want to negotiate with them, you know. And what I'm saying to you, you got to be prepared to walk away, but you have to have a strategy. See, you're really not walking away. See, you're on a dual track. You're there. Means you want to make the deal. So you go in there with, you know, a degree of confidence that you could do this, but if it doesn't happen, it doesn't happen. It's going to be all right. Furthermore, it doesn't happen at that moment. See, I have a habit. I would leave my cards with people. People try to give me their cards. I don't take cards. I give them my card. You call me. You know what happens? Things change in their life. They think it over. Many deals are made that way. They think it over. The worst thing that Americans, you know, people that are hanging around this country, Americans to me, Americans do is they're not patient enough. They want instant satisfaction. Instant gratification. They want the deal now. If you could wait one more day, just wait. Force yourself to live with anxiety, to live with uncertainty. You make better deals. You know? Now, you want certainty right away? You want the deal right now? You pay for it. Now, do I make many deals right now? Of course. I don't want to live with the uncertainty, but I know what the hell I'm doing. See, I have a sense of mastery of what I'm doing. That's what I think all of you should have. Yes? Any other questions? Yeah, you got questions.
Yeah. Can I ask a question?
Sure.
A friend of mine is American, but he's been in China for years. He speaks more Chinese. He said the negotiations with Pan Lunyong, which went on forever, he said that we put deadlines on ourselves. Let's finish by Christmas. Let's finish by 20th anniversary. And the Chinese, he said, will sit there, or the Koreans, and say, what have you done with your life? And he said, I negotiated with him. I had a chance to study him. So he's not in any hurry. Does that, internationally, is that
one
problem?
Yeah. Our problem is, I think some of you have my book. I think I mentioned that story in my book, how ultimately the negotiations, this is the end of the Korean War, we went to Paris, and the Chinese rented a villa on a year-to-year basis. We were renting at the Ritz Hotel monthly, you know? Which kind of like indicates, and they're prepared to use time. See why? They have a much older culture, which affects the way we negotiate. But one of our biggest problems, really, is time. I think I mentioned in that book that you have, and which is still true, three keys in negotiation are probably information. You want to get as much information as you can. Two, power, and we always underestimate ourselves. See, we sort of like follow the personal pimple theory of life. Which I mean by that is, because I know me, I know my faults, I know my weaknesses, and you sit there. See the way he sits there? Like, you don't care. You know, I spent my life sitting across from the table of people that didn't care. You know what I mean? They're like, you know, because they mask inside, they're churning and they're dying. But you're doing the same thing to them, see? But you kind of look at them and you feel, God, they don't need this as badly as I do. But they do need it. That's why they're there. See, we tend to manage by exception. What I mean by the personal pimple theory is, years ago I was telling one of you, I used to teach at the Graduate School of Business at the University of Michigan, and they didn't have blackboards for some reason. They had flip charts, you know. So at the end of the day, I would always get my hands, you know, filled with that marker, and I would touch my face, and I knew I would do this. And people come up to me sometimes and say, oh, you got something on your face, Herb. I say, where? You know, I was very sensitive to that. I go to the men's room, I didn't see anything. I come back, the guy says, no, it must have been the light. You know, and I go home, and I speak to the flight attendant. You know, she didn't see anything. I use the unisex bathroom on the plane. Speak to my wife, she didn't see anything. And then I go to the final arbiter of these things, the magnifying mirror, which all of us have in our homes. I didn't buy mine, you know what I mean? Because I'm not that vain. No one admits to buying it, but everybody has this magnifying mirror. And in this magnifying mirror, which blows up your head 92 times its actual size, every nothing is a something. This is not a little blemish. This is a disfiguring carbuncle enveloping your entire being. You walk into a room and people turn, oh, they see it. But in reality, they don't see it. See, you tend to see it. And we tend to look at our vulnerabilities and magnify them. We look at our weaknesses, our time constraints more than we should. And the third item that I said is time. If you could train yourself to be more patient, recognize who you're dealing with and how they view time, you can give people an incentive to make deals. So in other words, don't say you got 30 days to do this, is what people do. That's an ultimatum. People don't like ultimatums. See, even I try to tell, like General Motors is, you have a situation where you say, what do they call them, the new cars, the X cars, what do they call it, Saturn or something? Okay, Saturn. They say, oh, these things will go like hotcakes with people. No negotiation. No, a lot of people will view it as an ultimatum. And by the way, there is negotiation on those cars, right? $18,000? Oh, no, not less than 18. Hey, if I bought in cash, $17,826.82. I like the car. The guys are saying, come back with the rest. Get out of here. You know what I mean? Everything's negotiable. Okay? Now, the point is, but you say to someone, this is it. Even if what is it is reasonable and fair, they want to be a part of the decision-making process. See? And they perceive it as an ultimatum. So you got to, like, remember all that stuff and think about those things. And so I trust I've answered your question. I don't even remember what the question was, but I tried. And let me, in closing, kind of answer a question that many of you have been asking yourselves as I've been allowed to ramble on for this protracted period of time. And that question is, how did this guy get here? I will tell you a little bit more than what was said earlier. But ordinarily, by the way, my office receives many calls from people who want me to speak or do something. They never speak to me. I don't speak to them. And the reason is my fees are astronomical. And there's no way I can honestly justify making the kind of money I do. However, the people in my office, they care, but not that much. You call them up, they throw out any number to you. And by the way, that number is usually accepted because of the way it's presented. This is Herb's standard fee. You would want standard work, wouldn't you? What would that include? A guarantee to show up. Yeah, we kind of like that. Yeah, and 95% of the people take that. 5% say, what are you, crazy? We get Henry Kissinger for less. I don't even know who this 5% is. I don't work for them. So your representative calls, and they talk about Penn State and the fact I've been here before and had a nice time before, enjoyed it, and the group, and where it's going to be, and how I get here, and all this and that. Everything is wonderful. My office knows what's going to come up. You're usually going to get into a discussion of remuneration. Compensation, which usually begins with the rhyming couplet, and what would Herb's fee be? At this point, we come up with the astronomical number. This could be quite contentious. However, your representative, I don't know who did it. I do know who did it. He went against the grain. Instead of saying, okay, what's this going to cost us? You know, he said, what do you think Herb honorarium might be? Honorarium? What the hell is that? happen to know a little Latin. You translate that in English, it means you're getting less. You know? And the reason I know that, these people are prepared to give you more honor, which may leave over less arium. See, lucky for my side, the people in my office don't know Latin. They come back with the standard astronomical fee. Your side, instead of saying, what are you, crazy? What is this? I say, you know, he's worth that. He's worth three times as much. You're underpricing yourself. And if we had that kind of money at the university, believe me, it'd be our privilege, our pleasure, and our honor to give him that. However, we don't have anything in our budget. Help us. Does that work? What the hell you think I'm doing here? Thank you all very much.
Know what this is, but you may not, because I think he gave you even a lower honorarium last time you were here. So this, you can look at this as a raise.
See,
look at this. It's impossible to break into. It's hermetically sealed. No. This can be taken apart.
Start off with calculated incompetence.
Yeah.
And as most of us are going to be getting job offers in the next couple of months, hopefully, and I don't know if starting off with incompetency with my prospective employer would be the best thing when negotiating a salary. Could you provide us maybe a...
Yeah, what I would do is, in my interview with an employer, what I would do is say to myself, what I want to try to do at the outset is ask questions and listen to them and show them I'm listening to them and probe. You know, well, what is the company looking for? You know what I mean? In other words, instead of spending time selling yourself, you've presented them with some written material that's got your stuff on it. You know, people like individuals who seem to like listen to them. You know, in fact, they think you're like exceptionally smart, even though you haven't said a damn word. I've been in many meetings with people where individuals were completely silent, you know? And executives said to me, now that was a brilliant person. He didn't say a goddamn word. I mean, we're not dealing, you know, with all due respects, the business community, you know, are America's top executives, are not geniuses, you know what I mean? They're like the people in this room, you know? Some good, some bad, you know? In fact, many of them not as good as the people in this room intellectually. I mean, to be honest with you, a lot of them have great political skills, though, and we're in the right place at the right time. And so what I'm doing, really, is I'm trying to paint with a big brush, you know, because I want you to remember certain stuff. See, your natural inclination will not be based upon what I said. I've never found a person so persuasive that they would actually transform themselves totally into someone that's calculatedly incompetent, you know? But if you remember that, you know what it'll do? It'll change your behavior 2%. That's all I want you to do, really. That's what realistically you're gonna do. So instead of talking so damn much, you'll listen a little bit more. And what you'll try to do is differentiate yourself. Even, by the way, if you don't get interviews for jobs, and if you run down a little bit here, in other words, by that I mean,
If some of you will be hired off the campus, okay, and you'll get jobs, and that's great, and you'll get the job you want. Some of you won't, okay? Some of you won't. What you want to do is not do what everyone else does. Remember I said differentiate? The standard way you say to people, what are you doing looking for a job? Well, I answered an ad in the New York Times. How many people answered that ad? You know, how many people I want? Two. How many answered it? Probably 1,200, you know, people sent in resumes. So what's your odds on that? 600 to 1, right? What's the odds on the New York lottery? It's probably less. Play the New York lottery. You know, it's better odds. So what I would do is, if you want to work for IBM or Eaton or any of the companies that come here, and you go to their office somewhere, you know, wherever the hell it is, whether it's in Armonk or it's in Pennsylvania, you know, and walk in and say, I'd like to see the human resources people. And well, we didn't advertise a job. No, but I'm in the area. I want to be interviewed. Interview me. Okay? And they'll interview you because they got nothing to do anyway, human resources. Believe me. They're looking to kill time. They will interview you to have your thing on file and see why. What may happen is that minute, see, they say, we have no openings here. Baloney. If there's got 4,000 people in the building, they got three turnover a day. You know, they got people with typing out letters of resignation. As they tell you, there's no turnover. See, they don't know about the turnover. It's a big organization. See, whether you're talking about Bell Atlantic or whatever, you know, wherever you want to work. And then, if I really wanted to work for that company, you know what I would do? I'd come back the next day, and I would sit in the personnel office. I would get in before the personnel person got in. And then I would go around and look for a job. And then, when... You know, and then come back before they left, and then as they left, they'd see me in their waiting room. In other words, they would, you know, they would eventually stop. What are you doing here? I said, I'm waiting for a job, for something to open up. All right? Now, I would be spending more time in that company than they are. You understand? They would get to know me. They'd get to, so there's less risk with me, you know, than anybody else. If nothing else, I become memorable. And that's the way, you know, I'm talking about in a period where it's hard to get jobs, that's how you get jobs. You go against the grain. You do something crazy. You do something different. You approach people. You violate protocol. You don't have a job anyway. What the hell you were?
Well, I want to look good, you know. What do you care? I care for some executive somewhere I'll never work. Doesn't think this was appropriate for me to write to them directly. I violated their protocol. I mean, if you got a lot to lose, you know, you already got the job, you don't take risk. But if you don't have the job, hey, go around. Do that kind of stuff. You know, be different. You know, be unique. Be memorable. Do that kind of stuff. And, you know, and that's an important thing. It's an important thing to get a job and to recognize that in today's world, it's a mobile world. And the first job you're going to be in will not won't be where you'll be 10 years from now. I mean, even in the same company. I used to give a lecture to IBM, which was like heresy. I used to do this at Sands Point. It was called Managing Your Career. And the lecture was about how organizations have changed. They used to look like pyramids, you know, and now they look like compressed light bulbs. And the way people move, see, they used to come in and become like assistant salesman, sales manager, regional sales manager, branch sales manager, territorial, you know, like, you know, young people would come in at the bottom and old bags would emerge at the top, you know, and people would stay in one company. And then, but today there's, you know, people cross functions, people go out of companies, people come back to the same company. It used to be that people were like loyal to an organization. I used to say this to IBM like 20, 25 years ago. And they were loyal to an organization. And today, the workforce is loyal to their career and loyal to their profession. Now, and they kind of objected to it. One of the things I would say to them is that one of the things you want to do every day you stay with IBM is you keep your resume up to date. Because the relationship between a person and a company, an employee and a company, should be a reciprocal one. You stay with IBM because IBM meets your needs. And IBM will keep you as long as you meet their needs. That's a healthy relationship. And they would object to it. Management would object and say, well, no, we don't lay off people. We don't do this. We don't cut back. I said, baloney. You'll see. You know, if you're going to compete in today's world, you know. And obviously, I was right. I was right then. But, you know, I wasn't advocating that people leave.
I'm just saying, hey, keep your resume up to date. Keep your options open in today's world. Be loyal to yourself, your family, your life, and your values. That's really what counts. Be true to yourself. And at the same time, you could be a great employee in a company. They will love you. I mean, I work for corporations. They love me, really, because I really work my butt off, and I learn. You know, I learn so I could go leave them. And they, you know, benefited by kind of the efforts I put in. So, you know, kind of like remember that stuff and stay loose.
All right. Thanks again.